for the last 50 years. Your phone, your laptop, the entire internet has been powered by traditional computer chips. Chips that compute in perfect rhythm. But your brain works completely differently. It's chaotic, unpredictable, and only activates when it needs to. Yet it's capable of incredible things no traditional chip can match. Now, it seems we've built something very similar to our brain. This is a new chip, so small that it can balance on the tip of your fingernail. Yet, it thinks like a brain and remembers everything. And it turned out to be 100 times faster than the chips we use today, while consuming 500 times less energy. In this video, we will explore how this technology mimics our brain and why this might be the last microchip technology we will ever need. Right now, the world is hungry for computing power. AI chips are faster than ever, but they burn through energy like there is no tomorrow. Just imagine, the latest NVIDIA GPU uses roughly 1000 watts of power. Your brain? Only 20 watts. Less than a dim light bulb. And yet, your brain can match the computing power of Apple's latest chip with 28 billion transistors. Or imagine an owl. Its brain runs on less than 1 watt of power. Yet it can fly silently, spot a tiny mouse in near total darkness, calculate the perfect angle, and catch it, all in real time. If you tried to do that with a computer chip, you would need a dozen of them, plus lots of sensors burning hundreds of watts of power. And honestly, you would still probably miss the mouse. And that's the beauty of neuromorphic computing. Biological brains can do so much using very little power. And that's the reason why researchers have been obsessed with neuromorphic computing, building chips that think like brains. Today we will look at a new chip called Pulsar, a tiny brain-like processor only 3 millimeters wide. It's built by a small Dutch company called Inatera. Over 10 years ago, they quietly started experimenting with this idea. And now, it's real. A tiny chip that you can actually buy today. So, how do you even replicate a brain on a chip? Your brain has about 86 billion neurons. And it's very different from a CPU. In a CPU, everything is built out of tiny switches called transistors. And all those switches flip on and off in a perfect rhythm, because the whole chip runs on a central clock. For example, the latest Apple chip operates at up to 4 GHz clock speed, which means it's switching 4 billion times per second. This clock orchestrates every calculation happening on a chip. And the thing is, this clock is very power hungry. What's interesting, actually, our brain proves that we don't need all this complexity to handle incredibly complex tasks. Our brain is actually pretty slow, firing only about 40 times per second. The 86 billion neurons in your head don't wait for a central clock to tell them what to do. Each neuron just listens to tiny electrical spikes coming from its neighbors. But the most beautiful part about our brain is that it's actually an analog machine. Yes, it's chaotic if you zoom in. But if you step back, it all comes together to create something astonishing. Consciousness. When I used to design chips, now I supervise people in my startup, we are building silicon, but I used to design chips. And for a computer chip, we want every signal to be perfect, to reduce noise. While here, in this box, it's very noisy. And yet, our brain manages to turn all this noise into a useful computation. If you want to build a computer chip that computes like a brain, you need to start with a neuron, the basic building block. It's actually not a computing core, and not a memory either. It's kind of both at the same time. A neuron receives signals, decides what to do, and then sends a signal forward. That's computation. And because the connection points, called synapses, can get stronger or weaker based on experience, that's memory. So each neuron is like a tiny processor with built-in memory. To build a real brain-like computer, we have to copy that. And based on this paper, it seems they've built it in silicon using some sort of resistive memory technology. Resistive memory works in a way that it computes and stores information based on how easily electricity flows through it. You apply a signal pulse to the memory, and it changes how much electricity can go through it. On a neuromorphic chip, these neural network weights are stored directly in these memory devices. Just imagine, when the inputs arrive, the electric current flowing through the chip will flow through these memory devices, and that automatically does the multiplying for you, right at the place where the weight is stored. This means this chip can remember and compute in the same place, just like the brain. Now, before we dive into how this new chip works, its key application and main drawbacks, have you ever thought about how much of your personal information could be out there online? Your name, home address, phone number, even information about your family members could be floating around online. This happens because data brokers collect and sell your personal information without you even realizing it. This exposes you to risks of data breaches and personal security. And that's where Incogni, the sponsor of today's episode, comes in. Incogni helps you regain control by removing your personal information from the databases that data brokers rely on. I've used it myself, and you will be surprised how simple it is. You sign up, authorize Incogni to act on your behalf, and they send data protection law-compliant requests to these companies, forcing them to remove your information from their databases. And now, just recently, Incogni introduced a new custom removals feature. This feature allows you to submit links to the websites which expose your personal data, and then Incogni's privacy experts will remove it beyond their automatic system. And my favorite part, you can track every step of the progress in real time, right from your dashboard. As someone who values privacy, I highly recommend you to try out Incogni. It's a simple way to reduce unwanted spam and keep your data off the grid. Use my code INTECH at the link below to get 60% off the annual plan. Now, let's peel back the layers of this tiny chip. Inside, you will find two different brains working together. One is analog and spiking. This is the part mimicking the brain that we've just discussed. It features 1,000 neurons and basically runs approximation of neuron behavior. And sure, 1,000 neurons is nothing when we compare it to 86 billion neurons in our brain. It's nowhere near the real cognition. Yet, this tiny network of 1,000 neurons might be just enough to process data coming from some sensor, a camera, for example. And it does it by running a special kind of neural network, so-called a spike neural network, or SNN. Unlike regular AI models, a spike neural network works more like a brain, processing information through spikes and events instead of continuous signals. instead of constantly crunching numbers, it stays quiet most of the time. That's where the energy savings come from, and only reacts when events happen. Imagine a camera that doesn't record every single frame, but only reacts the moment a bird flies past. And this property makes spiky neural networks perfect for robots, sensors, or devices that need to think fast without draining a battery. And the second brain is digital, built to run convolutional neural networks, which is another type of neural networks. Let me explain. So if you look on the sketch, which I drew just now, I'm clearly not an artist. It's pretty ugly, but you're still probably able to guess that it's a house. Now, this ability to recognize images comes so naturally to us, but machines can't do that. And that's where we need convolutional neural networks that are specializing on this pattern recognition. CNNs are really good at looking at images or things that come in a grid, like pictures or even sound waves. So the CNN can zoom in into particular parts of this image and with the filters detect these parts. Just like our brain does, it detects some of these features in parallel. And so here they combine convolutional neural network and spiky neural network in one chip so that this chip can use CNNs to recognize patterns in the data and then spiky neural network to handle and react to the events. And it works in a way so that when we connect this pulsar chip to a sensor, it can hear and it can see. It can recognize images, process speech, and do it using almost no power. But unlike a biological brain, this chip doesn't need to spend roughly 30% of time resting just to be able to function properly. Picture this: a phone you don't have to charge for weeks, or a laptop that lasts a whole week on a single charge. AI that runs almost anywhere without draining power. Well, that future just got a lot closer. Inatera plans to bring this chip into billions of devices and sensors, so that cameras, microphones, and devices can see, hear, and think just like our brain. And all this data to be processed on this tiny chip without sending any data to the cloud. Right now, we have already a lot of sensors around us, in our phones, cars, factories, and even in our homes. And it's already clear that in the next years, this market gonna explode. Sensors will be everywhere, in buildings, factories, robots, and even our clothing. The result? A future where almost everything around us can sense, think, and respond. And in order to be able to understand what we see with these sensors, we need a lot of tiny and efficient chips. That's the market Inatera is going for. The idea of brain-inspired computing is powerful. Our brain outperforms the best chips we've ever built. But there is a risk. One big challenge of this technology is scaling. We've already discussed that 1,000 neurons is not enough. And to come closer to the capabilities of our brain, we have to scale it up. But there is a challenge. Parasitics. You can maybe double the number of neurons, but getting 10 times more will be very hard. If we try to scale the analog core, parasitics becoming bigger and bigger. And this makes bigger networks harder to run efficiently and also reduces the precision. I actually worked in the past on a similar chip. Here is my LinkedIn. So when I was reading this paper, something immediately caught my attention. Aside from two brains we've just discussed, this chip actually looks a lot like a microcontroller. A microcontroller is basically a tiny computer chip that controls simple tasks and devices. And you will find many of them in your everyday devices, like in your fridge, in your car, in your washing machine. So, this chip has all the usual microcontroller parts, which is good and bad news at the same time. Let me explain. The biggest problem of this technology is the market, because the opportunity is huge, but this market is very much cost sensitive. One thing I learned at Stanford that in a crowded market, in order to be just considered, you have to get noticed. And in order to get noticed, you need to build something new. So to add or to remove some of the features. For this in a Inotera chip, the brain-like, the spiking component is how they stand out in the crowded world of microcontrollers. The biggest problem here is that the microcontrollers market is a huge red ocean. So you can build the best ever chip, but you can't price it much higher. And that's a tough game. On top of that, big players like Infineon, ST, NXP, Nordic are already adding AI features to their chips. And even the smartest chip can fail if no one is ready to pay for it. In my opinion, long term, these chips won't replace the entire brain of the computer or compete with NVIDIA GPUs. Instead, they will power small, niche tasks like detecting objects or recognizing events. But before this mass adoption happens, we have to address another challenge, which is software. Because currently, programming these chips, these neuromorphic chips, takes special skills. Unlike normal computer chips, which have decades of software development, neuromorphic chips are starting more or less from scratch. Today, they still require a regular computer to help with training and setup. And doing it fully on the chip is still years away. And long term, the biggest impact is gonna be in robotics and factory automation. And this will be super exciting to watch. One thing is clear. Soon, we will live in the world with trillions of tiny sensors. And brain-like computing technology is still in its early stage, and no one knows if it will truly take off. But the world needs faster, greener chips, and nothing inspires this future more than the brain itself. And it all begins with a tiny chip that fits on your fingertip. My name is Anastasia, and you've been watching Anastasia in Tech. Remember to subscribe to the channel and check out all the links in the description box below. And don't miss the new podcast episode that is coming this week featuring Nick Harris, the CEO of Lightmatter. Thank you guys for your support. Love you. Gonna see you in the next one. Ciao.